Hello, dear friends. I am Dr. Denis Fedorenko, and the chief of our administrative department, Anastasia. We are here, and we are happy to see you again and to have a short webinar, short presentation, and to have a live discussion to answer all your questions. Our webinar will have two parts. During first part, I will give you update information about our experience to try to inform you about our recent researches, about the most important topics and questions. Also, in the second part, we are happy to discuss all your important questions and to have complete information about our activity and to give you useful information about condition after transplantation, about future perspectives, and about how to apply for this treatment, about general rules before and after transplantation. So, firstly, I would like to give you our updated information about our experience in topic of high-dose immunosuppressive therapy with autologous hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, mainly in multiple sclerosis. As you know, Maksimov Department of Hematology and Cellular Therapy was created in 2003. This is big governmental university hospital, and we opened a transplantology department 2 years later. In 2005, our department was named after famous Russian histologist Professor Alexander Maksimov, who created stem cell therapy. The first transplantation for multiple sclerosis was performed in 2005 in our hospital, but first transplantation in Russia was performed by our team in 1999. Since then, more than 3,000 autologous and allogenic transplants for hematological malignancies and different autoimmune diseases have been provided. On this picture, you can see our experience in the treatment of autoimmune disorders. We started our activity in 2005, and total we provided almost more than 1,500 transplantations for multiple sclerosis. Also, our activity includes transplantation for other autoimmune diseases like CIDP, neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorders, rare neurological autoimmune condition like stiff person syndrome. Also, we provide transplantation for autoimmune rheumatic diseases like lupus, arthritis, and systemic sclerosis, myasthenia gravis. Also, we try to provide transplantation for rare condition like primary Sjögren syndrome and other diseases. In spite of COVID-19 pandemic, we started our activity in 2020, and we provided for this year almost 200 transplantations, also mainly for multiple sclerosis. You can see the result of our activity on this picture. Our results are almost the same. The success rate event-free survival for multiple sclerosis is around 90%. 5-year event-free survival, almost 90% for whole group of patients. As you know, event-free survival success rate for relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis is higher than for primary progressive multiple sclerosis. For example, for relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis, success rate is around 95%, for progressive variant is around 80%. If you compare this positive result with other treatment modalities like disease-modifying drug, this success rate is very high. For example, success rate of the most effective disease-modifying drug like acralizumab, alemtuzumab is around 15-19%. So, as for also for relapsing remitting and for primary progressive multiple sclerosis, for secondary progressive multiple sclerosis, transplantation is the most effective treatment approach. Also, we found that quality of life improves significantly for people with relapsing-remitting multiple sclerosis. We can reach quality of life as in general population in 1 year after transplantation. Also, we found that quality of life improves in people with high disability level. But if you provide transplantation in early stage of MS, for people with a DSS 6 and less, we can improve quality of life significantly, and we can reach condition patient had 1 and more year ago, and sometimes reach the normal population quality of life. Also, we can improve quality of life for more disabled patients, but unfortunately, the later we provide this treatment, the less effect for on quality of life we have. So the idea of transplantation is the same as we discussed earlier. The earlier we provide transplantation, the better result. Long-term side effects. Transplantation-related mortality rate is quite low. In our hospital, our transplantation-related mortality is still here, unfortunately, but the rate is around 0.1%. All other long-term side effects quite predictable and well controlled. Fortunately, in this difficult pandemic time, we have never had severe COVID-19 infection in our hospital and after transplantation. There are two long-lasting symptoms, fatigue and alopecia. Summary. As we discussed earlier, transplantation is still a promising therapy of multiple sclerosis. This is the most effective treatment and quite safe. Transplantation-related mortality is almost zero, but effective rate is around 90% for whole group of patients. Better for relapsing-remitting multiple sclerosis, a little bit worse for progressive variant of multiple sclerosis. The best candidate for this treatment is a person with early multiple sclerosis with low disability level, younger age, disease duration less than 5 years, and relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis. But I want to tell you that progressive variant of multiple sclerosis is also good option for this treatment. Success rate is around 80%. This is quite good result for officially incurable disease. The vast majority of adverse events as a result of transplantation last for a short period of time and can be well controlled. Transplantation was accompanied by a significant improvement in patient quality of life with statistically significant changes in the majority of quality of life parameters. And we are not on the one place. We are developing new approaches, new treatment protocols, new chemotherapy regimens. So I would like to inform you about our new developments, our new protocols and programs. The perspectives are a development of new lymphoablative protocols, development of program of top of treatment for people with highly aggressive multiple sclerosis, combination of transplantation with intrathecal chemotherapy. This is when we provide chemotherapy through the lumbar puncture and send chemotherapy directly to central nerve system. Transplantation in combination with cellular therapy like mesenchymal stem cells, the position of second transplantation, and alternative treatment when we can't provide transplantation. We have patients with high level of disability, with high ADSS score, and we need to develop approaches how to help these patients. Our new conditioning protocol, not published yet. This is 6 days protocol. This protocol includes two medications, traditionally cyclophosphamide, but not 4, but 2 days and another new medication. It's widely used in transplantology. This is fludarabine during 6 days. Also, we provide this protocol in combination with monoclonal antibodies like rituximab. Our previous result effectiveness is the same as in traditional program. We started to give this treatment for people with comorbidities with high risk of complication and side effects like diabetes, heart, lung, chronic diseases, for patients with high body weight when it's too dangerous to give full dose of cyclophosphamide. Of course, our future result will show the rate of effectiveness, but previous result, this protocol is the same effective like our traditional 4 days program. And second transplantation. If we have success rate around 90% and provide more than 1,000 transplantation, unfortunately, we have people who relapsed or who progressed after first transplantation. So this is why we developed second transplantation approach. And indication for this treatment is acute multiple sclerosis, relapse or progression in the time more than 1 year after first transplantation. Clinically confirm and or MRI confirm active relapse or progression. Lots of people sent us letters what to do if I failed transplantation. So we developed this program. The answer is second transplantation, but using new chemotherapy regime. And there are two options. 6 days protocol based on fludarabine and cyclophosphamide, as I discussed earlier, but in combination with intrathecal chemotherapy. If you use intrathecal chemotherapy, we can provide high concentration of chemotherapy in whole body and directly in central nervous system. We consider that if patient has relapse after first transplantation, in this situation, patient has quite aggressive and resistant to treatment multiple sclerosis. So this is why we consider that it's quite important to give new chemotherapy and to combine this chemotherapy with chemotherapy directly through the spinal lumbar puncture, directly to central nervous system. Totally around 20 persons transplanted using this approach. There are no any serious side effects, and now we have, based on information we have from our friends, response rate is around 100%. But of course, further follow-up, further observation we show will give us additional information maybe a little bit later. And second option, this is chemotherapy using cyclophosphamide and another medication, BCNU. This is 4 days protocol when we use two medications and in combination with intrathecal chemotherapy also. And we develop program for critically disabled people when we can't give transplantation because of risk of side effects is very high and risk and benefits quite questionable. So we develop protocol how to help this difficult group of patients. We use the same intrathecal chemotherapy like during second transplantation. We send chemotherapy through the lumbar puncture directly to central nervous system. Also, we provide chemoimmunotherapy, but not in high dose, in moderate dose, using mitoxantrone and rituximab. To help with high disability level, we provide very effective supportive treatment in combination with active rehabilitation program using Локомату механотерапии. Отвалился. Also, now we are developing protocol of allogeneic mesenchymal stem cell transplantation. This protocol is under research. We have only one case, and we are starting this program. We are going to use transplantation as intravenous infusion and in future like intrathecal injection for clinically stable patients. Response rate of alternative treatment, not huge experience, around 15 patients, also 100%. All these patients have disease stabilization and improvement with better quality of life, and there are no any serious side effects. Transplantation treatment-related mortality rate is 0%. And important questions. We have lots of letters with requests about, with questions about vaccination in this COVID pandemic time. Actually, it's important to inform you that we recommend to get COVID-19 vaccine for 2-3 months before transplantation. Transplantation decreases number of antibody-producing cells, but doesn't affect on titer of antibodies previously produced. And the titer antibodies is usually a little bit less or the same after transplantation, so patients have protection after chemotherapy. Actually, we don't recommend routine vaccination after transplantation, only for medical indication. Vaccination can increase risk of relapses. Effectiveness of vaccination is much less if we provide it during first year after transplantation. For example, if we give vaccine, COVID-19 vaccine in the first year after transplantation, this is based on international experience. Success rate or effectiveness is around 20%, to compare with normal effectiveness is around 60-80%. So we strongly recommend to have vaccination before transplantation. It will protect you after treatment. COVID-19 vaccination is recommended closer to 1 year time after transplantation. Of course, it's quite difficult to predict risk and benefits of this vaccine. It's quite difficult to predict relapse rate, but COVID time changed our approach, and COVID infection can be quite dangerous, so we recommend to have vaccination. Also, vaccination should be used for important medical indication, difficult pandemic situation like now, and other medical condition like rabies, tick-borne encephalitis, and other condition when in situation if patient isn't vaccinated, it will be dangerous for life. Other routine vaccination should be avoided. The less vaccine we use, the better. Also, not necessary to repeat all childhood vaccination, revaccination after transplantation. We don't recommend it. And dear friends, thank you very much. It's quite short presentation, and I'm happy to share our updated information, our experience, and another part of our webinar is a live discussion, a live talk, and we are ready to answer all your questions. The chief of our organizing department, Anastasia, well known in the field, she is here and she will help me to organize our live talk. Thank you very much.
So thank you a lot, doctor, and I wanted to say hello to everyone. Thank you a lot that you have time and take part today in our webinar, and I hope everything is fine for you. You are fine nowadays in difficult period really for the world. So, and I hope you have good questions when you have so nice option to ask directly to doctor. So right now I can see just two people wanted to ask. I think, Mark, you will be the first. Mark was our patient as well. So, Mark, do you hear us?
Can you
hello.
Hear me?
Yes, for sure. Yes. Welcome.
Hi, Anastasia. Hi, Dr. Fedorenko.
Hello, Mark.
He's both again.
Nice to see you.
Yeah, you recognize me. I have my hair back.
Oh, yeah, we recognize you. Nice to see you. How are you, Bob?
Yeah, I feel absolutely fantastic. You gave me my life back after 17 years. I never expected to feel so good. I feel great. There's been plenty of improvements, plenty. And I feel
it's
what,
great.
That's what I wanted. As I come up to my 2-year period, can I expect more improvements in the future? Right now, I've got a very strong, healthy lifestyle. I do fitness 3 times a week, and I'm positive.
Yes, of course. On the one hand, improvement rate is quite unpredictable. The common experience shows that patients can reach improvement, usually had 1, 1.5, sometimes 2 years ago. And the quicker progression before transplantation, the quicker recovery. The earlier we provide transplantation, especially for active or aggressive multiple sclerosis, the better recovery. Of course, as I like to tell, we need to combine transplantation. You do all the best. We need to combine transplantation with healthy, active life. So, of course, if we are positive, if we are very motivated, if we follow healthy life, if we have hobby and positive mind, so removed the disease from our mentality, we have great chance for improvement. And I hope you will have great chance for further improvement. I would be happy to receive update information from your side. So, but really, I know condition you had before transplantation, you look really nice. And I'm very happy to know that you are getting better and better.
Yeah, it's incredible. And yeah, I don't know what to say to you, you know. Thank you so much for giving me my life
thank
back.
Thank you.
And the biggest bonus of the whole lot is I'm so happy, but my family are so happy. Our relationship as a family is just incredible again, you know. And MS robbed me of that.
Thank you very much. And don't forget, you are MS-free.
Yeah.
This is the most important thing.
Okay. Well, look, other people need to talk to you. So thank you again.
Sure.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a nice day.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay, you too. Bye-bye.
So we are going to another one person. We'll ask another question, doctor. To be ready.
Oh, thank you very much.
Okay.
We are ready.
Так, сейчас I push. Мне что-то у меня не выходит. Мирон. Hello.
Наверное, время нужно для...
Ну, либо я что-то не так делаю. Я нажимаю отслеживать видео. Ну ладно, звук у него есть? Мирон, do you hear us? Okay, we can ask another our future friend while we are wait. Steven, hello, my friend. Happy to see you.
Ты видишь меня, нет?
Да, do you hear us?
Oh, hello, yes. Nice to see you.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Hello, yes. We can hear you.
Excellent. Okay. Yes, obviously, after transplant, we have quite a compromised immune system. How long should we try to isolate ourselves for once we get out of the hospital and get home? Do we not get straight out?
Actually, we don't recommend to be isolated after transplantation. Lots of information isn't in the internet isn't correct. Like, firstly, this is about neutropenic diet, lots of non-correct information. We don't recommend neutropenic diet after treatment. We recommend to follow this diet only if patient is neutropenic. So, in isolation time in hospital. After treatment, everybody can eat fresh fruits, vegetables, salads without any restrictions. So the same information is about isolation. In this pandemic time, we recommend to be careful in contacts, to wear a mask in public places. Before COVID time, we recommended to do it during first 3 months because first 3 months are more sensitive than other time. Immune system works good, but more sensitive to infection. But protection level is enough. So not necessary to be in isolation, patient can walk outside, but in public places wear a mask. Also, another important thing, we recommend to avoid to be in close contact with sick person. This is quite useful for all of us now, but not necessary to be isolated from other people, to be only at home, not to go out. This is not true.
Okay. So if we're actually, so presumably not neutropenic by the time we actually leave hospital, but I guess fully still lymphopenic for a while, does that make any difference?
No. Patient is usually quite neutropenic in hospital first 8 to 10 days after chemotherapy and stem cell transplantation. In this period, we provide sterile condition isolation in our special rooms. After recovery, there are no any strict rules for isolation. So this is only during being in our hospital, not after.
That makes sense. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you too. So let's try again with Miran. I hope you work out with your problem with voice and we can see you now and can hear you now. Let's see. Ну, что-то у меня с ним не получается.
Не подключается, да?
Ну да. Sorry, guys, something not working.
А что-то не подключаются
so,
люди.
We'll try with another our зависть. Friend, Georg. I wanted to give you a turn. А где-то у меня, почему я не вижу отслеживать?
Yes, hello, do you hear me?
Okay. Hello, Georg, nice to see you. How are you?
Well, you know, I should be good. You know, mentally I'm fine, but I had my stem cell transplantation in October 2019, so it's 2 years now, and my walking is getting really bad. So, you cannot see any lesions in the pictures. So my question is, what can I do now?
Okay, if you compare your condition now and condition 1 year after transplantation, for example, approximately October 20, are you better, worse, or the same?
Worse.
Worse, so you are getting worse. Did you have MRI recently?
I had MRI at the beginning of the year. The pictures are fine. So mm-hmm. There is no new active lesions, nothing you can really see on the pictures. But my physical condition on walking is worse.
Okay, unfortunately, sometimes it's possible, and the problem is a second part of pathological process is degenerative process. If we provide transplantation for patients with moderate to high level of disability, we can improve and also we can stabilize condition because our main idea to prevent further progression. I remember your MRI before. I think you had active MS, and now you don't have active lesions, so we stopped inflammation. This is quite good result, but sometimes at the assess progression and walking progression, we notice it in some small group of patients is around 10-15%. In this situation, I recommend to use very active rehabilitation program. Maybe did you have trauma infection or something like this during last 6 months?
No.
And
I just had the vaccination with Pfizer.
Pfizer, and when did you have it?
The second one in March, and the third one now 2 weeks ago.
We have some information about temporary worsening in people after vaccination. Unfortunately, we don't have enough information to know, is it a MS-related problem, is this vaccine-related problem. Only time will show, but we notice that some people have new symptoms or worsening in old symptoms after vaccination or after COVID infection. Of course, in this difficult time, we can't recommend to avoid vaccination at all because COVID infection is very dangerous. Mm-hmm. And vaccination can prevent severe disease, like artificial lung ventilation and care unit, intensive unit care and something like this. But of course, the common rule for all autoimmune disorders, the more vaccine we use, the higher risk of worsening. Because COVID infection is quite new and we have new vaccine, we don't have enough information about possible problems and side effects. Maybe the reason is vaccine. So in this situation, I recommend to try to keep active rehabilitation program. Maybe the good option is to try to use symptomatic treatment, more symptomatic treatment like vitamin supplements. Maybe Fampira can help you. I think you know this medication. It improves nerve impulse conduction through the damaged nerves. And sometimes Fampira can help in working. It's not a MS treatment. This is symptomatic treatment. So let's try Fampira to make him maybe to start more active rehabilitation. And I think we need to repeat MRI in the closest 2-3 months again.
Can we do it when I'm coming to Moscow in like 7th, 8th December?
7th, 8th of December? Are you going to visit Moscow, yes?
Yes, yes.
Okay, no problems. Please contact with Anastasia. We can organize your MRI, no problems.
Хорошо. Thank you so much.
Спасибо. Thank you, you're welcome.
So, glad to know that we can see each other again. We wanted to see our friend, Maria. I see you want to ask any question.
Oh,
please
hello,
welcome.
Maria.
Добрый вечер.
Добрый вечер. How are you?
I feel so, so good.
Okay.
I promise I feel
nice
really
good.
Nice to
know. Nice to know.
But a few days ago, I had to go to A&E as I cough some virus, which is going on for maybe 3 weeks now, and I cannot recover at all. So my heart rate was quite high. They sent me to A&E. And then they did my blood work. You know, all my blood work at the beginning was absolutely perfect. It was going up and up and up. But now they told me that my, I don't know how to pronounce this, eosinophilis, if you know what I'm talking about. Eosinophilis, basophilis,
basophils, okay. Okay.
They're below normal now.
Changes in level of eosinophils and basophils is quite typical. This is the result of chemotherapy. For you and for all patients after transplantation, it's quite important to have good level of hemoglobin, enough oxygen transport, to have good level of immune-related cells like white blood cells or leukocytes and platelets to protect body from bleeding. So as I know, you have good numbers in these main three positions. Did you have COVID test, or do you know what kind of virus infection you had?
Just a seasonal flu, I think. It's not COVID, definitely not.
Seasonal
We've
flu,
had a few
so
tests.
I recommend to try to be active, to start rehabilitation again, to use vitamins and to follow healthy lifestyle, and you will recover, because sometimes after infection we have more symptoms. you are not too far after treatment, so sometimes it's possible, and everybody may can be weaker after infection, especially after virus infection. Also, viruses can affect total blood count to decrease and to increase white blood cells. I recommend to repeat this test in 1 month's time before Merry Christmas or New Year and send me or to Anastasia's email. Okay?
Okay. They suggested that I might need the injections for stimulate stem cells.
Usually it's not necessary. It's not necessary. We recommend stimulating injections only for people with very severe neutropenia. This is quite rare condition. If I see that patient needs it, so I recommend it, but this is quite not common situation. If white blood cell level is more than 2, but normal range from 4 to 10, it's quite safe. In case of level closer to 1 or the most important less than 1, we recommend stimulation. It should be prescribed by a local doctor or hematologist. But I am in contact, so let's make this decision. We recommend any supportive treatment for only for indications.
Спасибо большое.
Спасибо. Thank you.
Thank you a lot. Bye-bye. So, my friend, let's try the third time with Miron. He promised
me. Добрый вечер всем.
Good evening. Здравствуйте.
Nice to hear Russian.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Maybe I can ask it in the Russian, and the doctor will be answering in English if it's okay. Thank you. Доктор, здравствуйте, добрый вечер всем. У меня вопрос следующий. То есть, Лис, я хорошо понимаю, вот этот treatment, который вы говорите, что это stem cell treatment, после этого у нас Копаксон воспринимается. То есть, Лис, я хорошо понимаю, после этого вот после этого трансплантации, да, вот stem cell, значит, не надо будет дальше воспользоваться скопоксином и не будет прогрессивные вот такие вот эти, как это называется, да, вот эти релапсис. Да, то есть у вас есть дата, то есть после того, как вы это сделали, я думаю, что дальше вы будете проверять, что есть прогрессивность или нету. Я думаю, что потому что это новое лечение, то есть там, думаю, 5-10 лет вы делали, то есть нету пока даты о том, что после 10 лет это не надо будет еще раз сделать, если я хорошо понимаю, да?
Да, вот мне как вам ответить, на русском и перевести, или вы поймете?
Я пойму на английском, просто мне легче, я думаю, что всем тоже будет интересно, если спрашивать, то есть ответить на...
Thank you very much. This is quite a useful and a very interesting question. The question is about, do we need to use disease-modifying drugs and like Copaxon or other medications after transplantation? Transplantation is based on high-dose chemotherapy, and the idea of transplantation to remove all wrong immune-related cells. So our condition after transplantation is MS-free. So MS-free means no bad, wrong autoimmune cells. Medication like Copaxon and other like beta interferons can't remove these cells. So this is why the name of this treatment is not disease-cured, but disease-modified drugs. All this medication try to delay disability, to slow down MS, suppressing these cells, but not removing. So if patient doesn't have wrong cells after transplantation, so no targets for Copaxone and other medication. So if we have MS-free condition, nothing to treat. And our international experience shows that we don't need to give disease-modified treatment. The small group of patients who have very aggressive or highly aggressive multiple sclerosis, they need top of treatment to increase success rate, for example, from 70 to 90. This is treatment using special monoclonal antibodies like rituximab or additional chemotherapy using mitoxantrone, but during 1, maximum 2 years, not all life. There are two options,
right,
or anti-B cell therapy or mitoxantrone, but for only small group of patients with highly very aggressive malignant multiple sclerosis. This is quite rare thing. Usually we don't recommend Copaxone and other disease-modifying drugs after transplantation, and our experience is around not 10 years, maybe longer, of course. First transplantation in Russia was provided in 1999, second in 2000, so today we have 20 years of experience, but for single patients, and they don't have disease-modifying drugs, they are successful. So we have some people who had this treatment in 2005, 2006. They also treatment-free now, with success rate is around 80-90%. So of course, I think maybe longer, maybe for all life. Of course, relapse is possible. This is why I told about success rate, 95% for relapse in remitting, 78% for progressive variant of MS. But of course, this success rate is for group of people which are treatment-free after transplantation. So the answer is quite simple, okay. Not necessary to use Copaxone. You will stop at 1 to 3 months before, and we are not going to recommend it after.
Right. Can I have the second my question? So
yes.
After the treatment of the stem cell, do you have control MRI? So do you about the patients after, I don't know, how many controls do you have? Every half year, do you... we are need to send you the MRI about the activity of the SM, or maybe 1 year, 2 year. How many do you follow up the patient?
We have quite long follow up for some people who had this treatment and who are in contact with our team. This is 2005 and 2006, more than 10 years. Follow up is very important, and we recommend to have MRI annually, to have MRI with contrast, not only brain but neck and thorax, cervix and thorax, spine. Also, lots of our patients live far from Moscow, far from Russia, and we ask to be in contact with our team to send us report by email. If we need to compare, we ask to send CD or flash stick using postal service. We can compare because we have all information, all MRI of our friends before treatment, so we can compare. Some people prefer to visit our hospital for follow-up, but usually follow-up schedule is once a year is enough, and additionally, of course, for indications in case of any new symptoms or in case of any problems.
Right, thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you a lot, Miron. I just wanted to add maybe a little bit about MRI. Nowadays, it's not possible to come to us for MRI because hospital is closed for visitors. No, we hope it will be temporary. Just for short information, if you do it at home, please send us your report. For us, it's also very, very important.
Okay. Thank you for additional information. So... it's important because I agree absolutely. It's much safer to have MRI at home if you live far from Moscow. And of course, we can organize MRI follow-up only for very in quite difficult situation. We can provide additional admission if patient really need it. If he need to differ between relapse or progression. So, but in routine practice, it's possible to send us report or CD.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you a lot for your question, Neron. So let's continue with another our friend, Garrett. We wanted to ask what you have for us.
I really have nothing to ask. I just wanted to say
hello.
Thank you.
Nice
hello,
to see you. How are you?
I can walk. I can walk about 15 yards now.
I'm really happy. How are you? Nice to know that you are getting better. Did you start your swimming?
Yeah, I am. Thank you.
Okay, good.
Say that again.
I'm really happy
that you
are doing well, because you had very, very difficult
really
situation.
Thank you.
Okay.
Cool.
Thank you. What question do you have?
I think it was just...
I just wanted to say thank you. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Okay. So I'm really happy that you... I can see you and that I know that you are doing well because you had...
Stay right there. I can stand.
Good. Super. Good result. So please keep your activity, exercise as much as you can, and don't have big intervals, big long breaks in your rehabilitation program. It's important for you.
Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Thank you for this information. Thank you very much.
Cool.
Yeah,
that's
good day.
Good news.
Thank
good
you
news
a lot
because
for sharing.
He was in really dramatic
difficult situation
without any possibilities to walk.
Yeah. So, doctor, just want to ask a question for me because I translate one important question from another our friend. So, if patient who was treated already with interferon, Copaxone, or ocrelizumab is eligible for transplantation therapy? Is it possible also for primary progressive MS?
Yes, of course, it's possible, and almost all our friends who had this treatment had previously disease-modifying treatment using betaferon, Copaxone, natalizumab, or ocrelizumab. So some our patients had more than 3, 4, and 5 variants of disease-modifying drugs. I know about people who had 5, 10 years of natalizumab treatment. So, of course, transplantation is possible. But the common rule is the earlier, the better. As about primary progressive multiple sclerosis, I think transplantation is one of the most effective treatment option because all other modalities are not effective. I know that in many countries, neurologists only recommend to have rehabilitation or physiotherapy for this difficult group of patients. They use ocrelizumab for primary progressive multiple sclerosis with quite low success rate, 6-10% of disease stabilization. Transplantation give us 78%, so it's much better. So primary progressive multiple sclerosis, if only patient isn't critically disabled, is quite important indication for this treatment. Also, previous treatment is important, so it's important to know what patient had before transplantation, but transplantation is possible after different variants of treatment.
Thank you a lot for full
Thank
answer,
you.
Doctor.
Thank you for your assistance.
Thank you, friends. So I also get some questions how to send information, how to send examination. Please, you can find all contact details, our email address on our website. Don't hesitate, ask any of your questions. I will reply you directly. Check my email. I think it's easier to find our email addresses at the internet and, of course, on our website. We communicate easier. Please send, don't hesitate. Again, check our website and find all details there. And, doctor, just another one question from our former patient,
mm-hmm.
our friend.
Okay.
She
yes.
has had her transplantation 4 years ago, and I understand, I think so, I hope so, she's planning to have a child. It's very important for a woman. So she asked what exactly tests, maybe a special assessment she needs before planning, maybe any medication, maybe do you recommend something?
Okay, this is quite important, and we support children, pregnancy for people who really want to do it, and we usually recommend to start it 1.5, closer to 2 years after transplantation. 4 years is quite enough. Firstly, I am very happy that our friend is doing well and she is going to have a child, and I recommend to have new MRI with contrast, because during pregnancy it will be quite difficult because lots of contraindications for MRI. So before pregnancy, we recommend MRI, maybe neurological assessment and gynecological assessment. There are no any specific rules for delivery, for pregnancy follow-up in this time. Normal follow-up, normal examination as for other healthy ladies. So, but of course, new MRI is quite useful before pregnancy.
Thank you a lot. That's important to know.
Thank you.
What else I want to ask from another outpatient doctor? Please give us advice. If the patient cannot take vitamin D because he has sarcoidosis, how can he find another way how to improve that?
Actually, in this situation, not necessary to take poor vitamin D. Maybe multivitamins or fish oil supplements will be enough.
Mm-hmm.
Fish oil supplements will be enough. So I think this is good alternative option for this situation.
Thank you a lot. So, and I see also few our other friends wanted to ask questions. I hope so. And I see Nikolin. We hope to hear you as well, not only see you. So please welcome.
Oh, hello. Hello. Nice to see you.
I'm since 3 months I'm back.
Okay. Good. And, we remember you.
Yeah. my hair's growing. But I have a question. Since I think 2 weeks, I have now more trouble with walking, and I'm more tired. The first month I was doing really great. It was amazing. But lately it is now a bit harder to walk. Is it normal to become, having your old disability back for some time?
Sometimes it's possible, and the name of this condition is early post-transplant period. So I usually inform about it usually first 3 to 6 months, more often 3-4 months can be temporary difficult, because first improvement is a result of strong anti-inflammation, anti-inflammatory treatment, using of steroids, which make us stronger. But chemotherapy was quite strong. And the most common condition is chemotherapy-related fatigue. And our research shows that quality of life starts to improve from 3 to 6 months time with trajectory to 1 year time. So I think this your condition, your temporary worsening is short term. I think in 1-2 months you will be much better. Have active rehabilitation, but with enough rest. Don't push yourself. Try to find good balance between activity and rest. Use, as we discussed, healthy food, vitamin D supplements. And of course, you are closer to 3 months. We are waiting for your new blood test results.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Please update us later. Update us later, for example, in 1 month's time about your condition. I think you will be better.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I wish you to recover. I wish you to recover as soon as possible. Yes. You are in early stage after transplantation, so it's okay to be tired now.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a nice evening.
Okay. Take care, dear Nikolin. So another our friend wanted to take part as well, Flavian. We are ready to hear you, to see, and I hope to answer on your question.
Oh, hello. Не слышу.
Ой, у нас звука нет. Sorry, just у нас звука нет, товарищи. My friend, turn on your microphone, please. We don't hear you.
And try to switch your microphone on because okay, it's okay.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Anastasia is scheduled me on May next year, but I have one question because I have Lyme disease, which I discovered in Germany after many analyses, LPT, Western blood, CD57, and they say for sure that I have Lyme disease. My neurolog doctor or all neurolog doctor, neurologist doctor saying I'm having multiple sclerosis without any doubt. I want to ask you a question. It is necessary before I came in Moscow to do some Lyme analysis. Do you request some analysis which I must do before? Thank you.
Okay, Lyme disease and borreliosis is possible. It can trigger MS. Also, patient can have two diseases, Lyme diseases and multiple sclerosis. Sometimes it's quite difficult what is the main problem. But if you don't have active infection, if you don't have fever and signs of acute infection, I agree with your neurologist. I think because this is neurological condition, autoimmune neurological condition, and usually Lyme disease is quite shorter and with another signs and symptoms of acute infection. So I also consider you have mainly multiple sclerosis. But to be on the safe side, I recommend you to check your blood for immunoglobulin M and G, to check your titer of immunoglobulins 1 month before admission to our hospital, and you can send us the result.
I don't understand
the
immunoglobulins. This is
test for borreliosis. Immunoglobulin M and G level 1 month before admission.
Okay.
Also, we can do it in our hospital, but better to have information about that you don't have any acute infection, just to be on the safe side. You can have a test for borreliosis and send us result 1 month before your admission.
Okay. There is another test which is made in Lyme. CD67, it's okay if I do this analyze, CD67?
Yes, it's okay.
For Lyme?
Yes, yes.
Okay, I will do CD67 and immunoglobulin analysis before I came to you.
Okay, good.
It's okay. Just one question. I have problems with sleep. It's okay to use melatonin?
No problems. You can use melatonin or any other sleeping pills. Also, sometimes we give sleeping medicine in our hospital in case of sleeping problems. All symptomatic treatment is available before and during this treatment. So no problems at all.
Okay. I just wait to meet you next year.
We are looking forward to meeting you. Welcome to our hospital.
Nice evening.
Thank you.
Thank you a lot. Yeah, really, next year is so soon, doctor. So
in 1 month.
Yes. So the next one.
Do you have other questions?
Yes, we have other questions, doctor. I hope you have a patience for us.
We are really happy.
No, okay. It's really a unique situation. We have to discuss all our important things. And the next one, Gunit, please take part with us. Hope to.
And it's our friend from India.
As well, yeah.
Hello. How are you?
Hello, good evening, doctor. How are you? Very well, thank you, doctor.
Fine, thank you.
I would like to thank you for the treatment. I've been post 5 years and I'm doing very well. I would say I'm stable.
And 5 years is good time. Good time. So
right. just a couple of questions I had. I've been following up with you with regards to the vaccination as well, but that's no. I'm having some symptomatic concerns, which I feel do bother me. I do get involuntary movements of my legs while I rest. So I'm not able to figure out if there is something that I can do to help in that.
You mean you have muscle spasms?
Yes, involuntary movements, yes.
Okay.
When I'm resting.
Okay, firstly, I'm really happy that you are stable after so long time, and because the main idea of treatment to prevent further progression. What about your situation? I recommend you firstly to check your blood for electrolytes level, like magnesium and other. And also, maybe it's good idea to check your legs vein using ultrasound and to discuss with your neurologist why you can have it. Because lots of reason for muscle spasm, for spasticity in legs, from vein problems to nerve problems to muscle problems. If it's something new, and of course, when did you have last MRI?
Almost. 2.5 years ago.
So another thing, we discussed it with our previous friends that follow-up should be done annually in spite of stable condition. So let's start with MRI with contrast, as we usually recommend in our medical report, to have it once a year. Also, you have mine and Stasia's contact details. Send us a report of your MRI. And also update us with your recent blood test results, total count, biochemistry with electrolytes level. If everything is okay, the next step will be legs ultrasound. And the third stage, if you can't find the reason of your problem, is electroneuromyography. So, but let's start with the most important thing, MRI.
Sure.
Be in contact with our team. We will try to help.
Great. Thank you, doctor. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think everything will be okay. It's not a problem with MS.
Okay. So, Melanie, I know you wanted to ask also your question. Please take part. We are ready to hear you.
Hi, Dr. F and Anastasia.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
I hope you're doing fine.
Yes, I hope you're doing fine also. So nice to see you.
So, thank you. I'm doing great.
Okay,
I have a question. I'm 9 months post-transplant today. And I haven't been vaccinated for COVID yet. But is it better for me to get the vaccination or should I wait and get infected if it is better for my immune system, or
Actually, as I told during my short presentation, nobody knows about risk and benefits of vaccination for MS, but 100% that vaccination is quite useful to prevent severe COVID infection. Also, lots of restriction in our nowadays we have lots of restriction with COVID certificate and QR codes for people who are not vaccinated. So you are closer to 1 year time. So if you are active, if you have to be on public, it's better to be vaccinated.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'll do it. Yeah. Thank
you. Keep us informed about your condition. Bye.
Bye.
Good question. I am happy that we repeat it because, as I see, some guys still ask the same question. It's okay. Really very important problem for nowadays. And really, friends, it's more safe for life, really.
Yes, because this is a kind of not only medical rule, this is kind of social rule.
You're right.
One of the first transplantation, I think you know this lady from Australia, it was 2011 and much before COVID time, and we didn't recommend to have any vaccination for this lady after transplantation. And as I remember, 4-6 months later, I received letter from this patient, and she told me that I work as intensive care unit pediatrician department as a nurse. I have to be vaccinated against influenza. I have to have this flu shot, because if not, I will lose my lovely job. So this is social reason. So before COVID time, some people had to be vaccinated because they work in schools and kindergarten and hospitals. So now in COVID time, almost all people have to be vaccinated, and we need to live in a new condition, so we need to collect more information about risk and benefits, possible side effects. But I think the reality is that all we have to be vaccinated earlier or later.
That's true, friends. So anyway, we can continue. As I see, we have another friend, Trine. Maybe you take part now. Happy to see you. You look nice.
Oh, hello, Trine. Nice to see
hello.
You.
Same to you, Dr. Fedorenko. 9 months post today, actually.
Good, like good. Melina. Congratulations. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm doing really, really good.
Good. Very really happy.
Yeah. Well, I have a question. I think you almost answered it before for another guy who asked, because the Danish doctors would also like to put me and Melina on the rituximab. Maybe once a year after treatment to prevent MS coming back. What do you think about that?
This is question about top of treatment. Top of treatment should be used only for highly aggressive MS. So actually, we didn't find any positive results for people who had rituximab only for prophylaxis. Well, small experience, but actually, if in case of quite ordinary MS course, it's really not necessary because we give very strong chemotherapy. Mm. On the other hand, in COVID time, additional immunosuppression and monoclonal antibodies increase risk of infection. So it's much more dangerous for us, for MS, also for possible relapse. So I think not necessary.
Okay.
Actually, in case of problems, in case of confirmed relapse, I don't want to think about it. But we can start with rituximab in case not for prophylaxis but for treatment, because there are two variants of relapse or progression treatment after transplantation. This is rituximab or ocrelizumab or second transplantation. So, in case of treatment failure, we can start rituximab, but I don't recommend it for prophylaxis.
Okay.
Because it can't improve the result of transplantation after so strong treatment.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Feringer. We'll never
Thank
forget
you.
My birthday in Moscow this year.
Thank you. Let's be in contact.
Thank
and
you.
Take care. Bye.
Okay. Bye.
Great. Nice to see your friends who have had treatment and now can
All
talk
questions?
With us a little bit. No, doctor, I have a few more. I hope you can breathe well
it's
and ready
good.
For more. So now we are ready to accept question from Liana, and I hope she is ready to take part as well.
Hello, Liana.
Liana, maybe turn on your voice. Что-то у нас не выходит. We don't hear you.
Но там такое ощущение, что висит картинка.
Нет, нет, двигается видео, видишь, а звука нет.
Yeah, hello,
we don't
hello.
Hear... А как ей? Она слышит нас?
We can't hear you.
Liana, do you hear us? Because we don't listen.
We can't hear you, unfortunately.
Anyway, we can ask someone else. And I see Monique. She has been in our department just a few months ago. And I think wanted to ask something interesting with us, doctor.
Okay, hello.
Hello.
Nice to see you.
Nice seeing you too. You guys have been amazing. And every day I get better and better. So
nice
I have a
to
question
know.
For you. Thank you. Thank you. How many days do you recommend for physical therapy?
Physiotherapy program is quite individual. So actually, on the one hand, we don't recommend to be too active. You should listen to your body.
Mm-hmm.
Don't push yourself. You should do it regularly, usually 3-4 times a week. But sometimes if you
okay.
feel that you can do more, this is only supportive. And
okay.
we recommend to
okay.
slow increase of intensity. So please have physiotherapy. Maybe in the beginning with physiotherapies, later you can do it partly with physiotherapies, partly your own. But the
mm-hmm.
more the better based on your condition. Firstly, you should enjoy it. You should be tired, but not exhausted.
Right. Okay,
good.
Thank you.
Thank you very
yes.
much. Take care awesome. And have a nice evening.
Thank you, too.
Yeah, that's a good rule, friends. Take care about yourself. Don't push. Enough exercises, good rest. Combine excellent life.
Logic lifestyle.
Exactly.
Logic lifestyle.
So we try to return to Liana. I hope we work out without problem. Liana, do you... Yes, now
yes,
we listen
yes,
to
we
you.
Can hear you.
Okay, I will do it in Russian if it's okay because my English is not good enough.
Yes, you can do it in Russian. No problems.
Окей. Так, моя мама, она в прошлом году в ноябре переболела короной, и сейчас в июне она собирается к вам, в следующем году в июне.
Угу.
И вопрос, ну, ей обязательно делать вакцинацию или нет?
Окей, the question is, can I translate, yes?
Да,
the question is about if patient had COVID infection in this summer or 6-12 months ago, and is it necessary to have vaccination? Yes, vaccination is recommended 6 months after infection. Через 6 месяцев надо привиться. Соответственно, следующий год будет больше 6 месяцев. Поэтому, чтобы нормальная защита выработалась, надо привиться за 2-3 месяца до приезда к нам. И как раз будет хороший интервал, почти год, между инфекцией и вакцинацией. Но перенесенная инфекция не запрещает, а наоборот, через полгода после коронавирусной инфекции уже надо прививаться. И прививаться сейчас, говорят, надо раз в полгода. Болел или не болел коронавирусной инфекцией, все равно прививаться надо. Вот после трансплантации лучше год подождать. А перед трансплантацией эта защита обеспечит поездку, путешествие, пребывание в России и останется на период, когда иммунитет еще ослаблен. Поэтому привиться желательно. So I told that it's strongly recommended in spite of previous infection to have COVID vaccine before starting our treatment. Better 2-3 months before admission to our hospital. The period after COVID infection and before vaccination is usually 4-6 months. It's enough. So in spite of previous COVID infection, we recommend to have vaccination if we have 6 months after infection. So если 6 месяцев прошло, прививайтесь.
Ну, а если она не хочет?
Но это безопасно. Даже если рассеянный склероз ухудшится, она едет на лечение, мы это исправим.
Ну, у нее не рассеянный склероз, у нее миелитис трансфера.
Ну, это тоже аутоиммунное заболевание, да. Аналогичное с группой рассеянного склероза. Вот, ну, конечно, если человек не хочет, заставить невозможно. Но вы попробуйте взять тест на антитела. Если антитела низкие, то вообще ездить опасно. А говорят, в следующем году будут такие правила, что авиакомпании не пустят в самолет, если человек не привит. Поэтому, может быть, придется точно прививаться. Я об этом слышал, что будут пускать самолеты только привитых. Или переболевших недавно.
Подожди, Стульчик, уже время мало, давай прививаться и все.
Прививаться. Thank you very much. I told about that vaccination before treatment is very recommended.
Yeah, so everyone knows, understand, I hope, that COVID totally destroyed our normal life, so we have to play with new rules. So another guy, Aurel, please take part, because time is going and running, and I hope you can quickly ask your question. You're welcome.
Добрый вечер, доктор Спринг.
Здравствуйте. Good evening.
Just to let everyone know, I'm almost 3 years post-transplant, had COVID in November, did the vaccine in March, got hospitalized with real bad immune reaction afterwards because of the vaccine, very decompensated afterwards. Today I had a meeting with my neurologist here in United Kingdom, that it's also doing the hematopoietic procedure here in UK. And he actually advised me not to do the second COVID vaccine, because it's more likely I'll have a real relapse because of the first one. At the same time, he recommended me to go on ocrelizumab. Should I take this?
У нас была трансплантация,
да?
Да. Okay, did you have MRI? Did you have MRI? Do you have confirmed relapse?
No, not a confirmed relapse. I had the MRI in June, and they said it was like a false relapse. It was an immune reaction, and it was a spike of the old system, all the symptoms, which is extreme fatigue, instability, muscle pain.
Mm-hmm. Of course, I'm very sorry that you had a bad reaction to vaccine, and I agree. Only one contraindication to COVID vaccination is bad reaction to vaccine, any variants. Neurological worsening, allergic reaction. If patient had bad reaction to first vaccine, we also recommend to avoid further vaccination. So it's correct. It's correct. Absolutely. No more vaccine if you had bad immunological reaction.
But ocrelizumab?
If you have neurological worsening, I think it can be triggered by vaccination. Unfortunately, it's possible. I agree with ocrelizumab. Because ocrelizumab is one of the useful treatment option for people who getting worse after transplantation. Rituximab or ocrelizumab or second transplantation. So we also recommend ocrelizumab. We agree with your doctor.
I see. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have a nice evening.
Thank you as well, doctor. I hope it can be useful information for others. Difficult life.
Difficult questions, yes, so, and very important.
Important, for sure. Every question is important. And friends, again, thank you a lot that you could find time and take part in our meeting. And I wanted to introduce our friends from America, Melissa. We are ready for your question, doctor.
Hello.
Hi, Dr. Federico. Hi. How are you?
Hello. I'm okay. Thank you. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you. I'm so happy to be part of this group today.
Good. Good.
My question is the stiffness that you experience, is that a side effect of HSCT or is that just the MS?
You mean stiffness after transplantation?
Yeah, increased stiffness.
Yes, sometimes when patient is getting more and more active with quite intensive rehabilitation program, after lack of mobility, stiffness is possible or muscle spasm. So try to find balance if you exercise too much. Try maybe to have some more rest. Also, for stiffness, we recommend physiotherapy, massage, any other variants of physiotherapy, and magnesium supplements. Try to find maybe is this stiffness related to physical activity or this is night stiffness. If the stiffness related to physiotherapy, to activity, to your exercising, try maybe to cut down, to decrease intensity. And to use magnesium supplements, usual dose is 1,000 milligrams twice a day. It usually helps a lot for stiffness.
Okay, thank you so much.
If not, if it's not enough, send us message. We will discuss it privately by email. Maybe if you need more treatment like baclofen or other medication which relax muscles can be useful. But I think magnesium will be enough.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a nice evening.
Thank you. Thank you a lot. Hope you will be better soon. So, another our friend, Mary, please take part and join with us.
Hi.
Hi, Mary. Hi, Mary.
Hi. My son is joining you in January next year.
Great. And
I've just got a very quick, he's online as well, I believe, but just a quick question. For example, my son also has Crohn's disease. How does HSCT make any impact on that, or will it continue to have Crohn's even after the stem cell therapy?
Good question. Crohn's disease is also autoimmune disease, and the mechanism is quite similar, only different targets. It was protocol of using transplantation for Crohn's disease, and protocol is the same like for multiple sclerosis. So success rate for Crohn's disease, especially for early stages, success rate of using transplantation is around 50-60%. Less than for multiple sclerosis, but chemotherapy is also effective as a good immunosuppressive approach for Crohn's disease. So I hope your son will be better with Crohn's disease also.
Okay, well, that's good to know anyway, but it doesn't matter though. I mean, the other thing I wanted to ask, it won't make it worse having, you know, the stem cell.
No. This protocol is the same treatment like for Crohn's disease separately, because transplantation for Crohn's disease is also based on the same chemotherapy.
Okay. And
this treatment is quite effective. No, it's quite useful for Crohn's disease also.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you. You are welcome.
Thank you.
Okay. Great, doctor. Continue. Just a little question, but important. And I just read it from Patrick.
Mm-hmm.
He has had already a treatment with us. And his question. And why I wanted to ask, it's a quite often questions from our patient. He has a pain in hips, and test results are fine, and he asks, is it possible that it's related by transplantation, or maybe he needs hip replacement? Can it be after treatment?
Thank you, Anastasia. It's an important question. So the answer is quite simple. Mm-hmm. If patient has a strong pain, hips pain or joint pain during first months after treatment, the most common situation that this pain is related to transplantation, like recovery or engraftment pain, or as a result of finishing steroids. If patient has delayed pain, more than 1 month, more common 3-6 months, this is not typical for transplantation, for as a side effect of transplantation. So patient needs to have additional examination. For example, the most common is hips MRI.
Mm-hmm. Thank you a lot. Hope it can be useful as well.
And based on hips MRI, we can make a decision about hips replacement or physiotherapy or treatment in tablets. So,
thank you. So anyway, you can send again us any your medical report. I think blood results we would like and would be happy to take part and make decision together. So another our guys have question, Kashish. She also had already treatment. And
hello.
Hi, doctor.
Hi.
This is Sajal. I am Kashish Agarwal's husband.
Mm-hmm.
She's been doing fine. So really thanks to you and the team who treated her. The question is, she got the transplant in September 2017. And she got COVID infection this year, and she recovered normally, you know, like in 15 days time in the month of May 2021. Is it recommended that she should go for a vaccine? So far, she hasn't taken any shot.
Okay. Depends on titer of antibodies, but COVID situation is quite difficult in Europe and the USA, all around the world. So in that period of 6 and more months after infection, vaccination should be done. Only one contraindication for vaccination, there are two contraindications, acute infection. We should avoid vaccination in the time of acute infection. And another contraindication is allergies. So if patient had COVID infection in May, so now almost 6 months left, So we recommend that maybe not right today, maybe December, after New Year, January, February, but it should be done.
Okay, and even if she recovered, like normally the severity of the COVID was not much, is it still recommended?
Because...
Like you say that... you're not sure of the risks and benefits of the vaccine.
We are not sure about risk and benefits, but COVID infection is quite unpredictable. And first disease can be mild, second disease can be moderate or severe. And different mutations and different variant of COVID virus, like Delta variant, which is around, this is different infection, another infection. So 1 year ago, we had another COVID. Now COVID is new. So, actually, it's quite difficult questions because nobody tell you about risk and benefits. But common medical rules are to have vaccination every 6 months in spite of infection. So this is international, a kind of international standards to protect life. So look, if your wife has vaccine, for example, first shot, and you notice that it's not good for her, she starts to have any new symptoms, stop. I think it will be temporary. But if she is doing well, because 90% of people with MS and after transplantations, they don't have any serious side effects of vaccination. Lots of research in neurological society. Quite rare that patient is getting much worse in MS after vaccination. Not typical. So I hope everything will be okay. But of course, this is personal decision. We can't recommend strongly, but the modern situation that it will be necessary for all of us. For example, I also... had to be vaccinated in winter and summer and every 6 months in spite of, for example, mild infection. 6 months ago, I had this vaccine because risks. Also, this situation is based on public activity. If your wife is around public places and has to walk with people, it's position of safety, not for only for your family, but for other people also. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you a lot. And I wanted to ask quick questions, very strict.
Okay.
Our good friend Brooks Lick asked me, if we start a new protocol, will we able to help with people with EDSS higher than 6.5? Will we accept such patients?
Okay. Dear Brooks, thank you very much for this question. This is quite important. It depends on MRI. Actually, if patient has inflammation and high disability level, we can provide alternative treatment if we see that this treatment will help. If patient has high DSS level, but quite stable situation, like a DSS 8.5, today 8.5, 6, 12 months ago, we can't affect on this condition. If patient is progressing from 7 to 7.5 to 8, we can do it.
Thank you a lot. And another one question, also quite often people ask, I want to more patient just listen about that. Is it possible that we don't use steroids sometimes with our treatment or we can't avoid? How can it be solved, that question?
Of course, we have people with diabetes, with bone problems, with osteoporosis, with psychological problems. They can't tolerate steroids. We don't treat with steroids. Steroids only help with symptoms during this sometimes difficult treatment. So we can reduce steroids dose, or in case of diabetic situation, we can remove steroids at all. It doesn't affect on treatment result. Maybe a patient will have more treatment-related symptoms, but we can remove steroids from our protocol. This is 100%.
Okay, great. So everyone, again, is unique. Each case is possible to discuss.
The most important is to keep to provide right chemotherapy, because the effect of transplantation is a result of right chemotherapy. Steroids, symptomatic treatment, this is only supportive treatment. Mm-hmm. It can be changed personally. This is personalized approach. But chemotherapy is calculated based on body weight, high and personal things. But the protocol is the same for all people.
Good. So focus on chemotherapy and maybe good rehabilitation home. So, and I think, as I see, just maybe last question for today. Andreas wanted to ask us also something for tonight.
Okay. Hello.
Hi, Dr. Fedorenko.
Hi, nice to see you.
Very nice to see you. I can't wait to come in January. I'm really excited. I'm not sure if other people have this question, but work's a big part of my life, and taking out a solid month, I wouldn't have imagined it, and I think that's one of the reasons I've put this off for so long. So during that time, should I entirely put work aside and say, okay, I'm not going to work for that month at all?
Or you mean 1 month after transplantation?
No, in the month I'm in Russia, is that like no question, you don't do any work?
Когда он у нас, я так понимаю, уже будет.
Okay, you mean can you walk outside? Yes?
Work remotely, on your laptop.
No problems. It's not a problem. You will have separate rooms with the internet access. You can use laptop, mobile phone. You can walk without any restrictions all time if you want. No problems at all.
In terms of energy, is it something that you would recommend or not recommend, but do you think it's realistic in terms of focusing on getting your energy better, or is there a stress element that comes in that makes it impractical to work?
You mean fatigue and lack of energy, yes?
Yes, and if for instance you had work stress, would that compromise your treatment in some way?
We should find the best balance between our lifestyle and rest and physical activity. Fatigue and lack of energy is one of the most common symptoms of autoimmune disease patients. And I think it will be much better. Of course, we recommend to follow normal lifestyle, but on the other hand, we recommend to avoid too much stress, not to sleep at all, to be too active, to work hard without any rest. This is another negative side of our life because it's stressful. We have tried to find the best balance between our work, our activity, our rest. So the other side is rest all time without any activities. It's also not useful. So try to find the best balance to walk enough. Sometimes if you need to walk this time or 1 week or 1 month, for example, you need to walk hard in this time, it's okay. But if you do it months and years and it's quite stressful, you feel awful, exhausted, stressed, depressed, it's not good. And because all we are different, so for some people intensive work isn't very good, for some people it's quite useful. So it depends on you.
Okay, cool.
It depends how you feel after it. If you enjoy it, if you feel fine, it's okay.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you a lot, friends. And doctor, just want to maybe make a final conclusion. We have spoken about chemo, and that is one of the most important. And just want to clarify that question, because as I see still misunderstanding between 4 days chemo and 6 days chemo. What's the difference? But effectiveness is the same, right? Mm-hmm. As I said. But what's the difference? Just different medication we combine, right?
Yes, for example, previous results show that the effectiveness of this treatment is the same. Traditional for this chemotherapy based on the maximal, the highest dose for cyclophosphamide, this protocol has some limitation because in some patients it's quite dangerous. Mm-hmm. For example, we can't give this dose for overweight people. It's more dangerous for people with heart, lung problem, with heavily pretreated people. Mm-hmm. With high level of disability, and for example, with people with comorbidities like diabetic patients. So because we decrease in 6-day protocol, we decrease dose of cyclophosphamide twice, 100 milligram for kilogram body weight, but to keep effectiveness of 200 milligrams, we give second medication, fludarabine. Mm-hmm. So we partly remove toxicity of cyclophosphamide, and we combine with another medication, so we can provide full dose chemotherapy for people with restriction to have 4 days protocol with the same result.
I see. Thank you a lot. So
this is why we found that we have less strong side effects.
Yes.
No mortality at all, because we started to give a little bit safer treatment for people with risk of complications.
Exactly. So the main things. Effectiveness is safety. Less risk for life and
but this treatment condition. Isn't less intensive, isn't less effective.
Well, it is the most important. So I think we anyway need to finish for today. Friends, thank you a lot for taking part.
Do we have
for
more
your friends.
Questions or no?
Not so much, usually quite similar. And we answer on all questions. And anyway, friends, if you have any more, please send to us again. Don't hesitate, ask any questions. We will reply by email or phone, of course.
Dear friends, thank you very much for your interest, for this useful and good discussion. And also, we are ready to answer private questions via email. And another important thing, dear friends, we are open. And if you feel that we need more live talks, more webinars, let's be in contact. We can provide additional talks maybe in 3-4 months time when we collect more information, when you have and sent us more requests and questions. So we are ready to provide more often our talks, our live discussions. So I wish you all the best. Merry Christmas and New Year coming. So all the best in New Year. All the best to your friends and family. So and good luck. Я не впустую говорил?
Нет, я думаю, все нормально.
Окей. Okay.